Hello, I'm Nadia Pereira. I am part of a research team working in the field of cyberbullying at the Faculty of Psychology of the University of Lisbon. And today I'm going to present you a communication which is entitled How Teachers Morally Disengage from Cyberbullying Incidents. And so I will begin by addressing some main aspects of cyberbullying. Cyberbullying is often defined as aggressive and intentional behavior, which is repeatedly perpetrated over time through electronic devices by a group or an individual against a powerless person. So, according with the literature, there are key main defining features of cyberbullying: the repetition of behavior, the intentionality to harm another person, the occurrence between peers, the use of technological means to perform the behavior, the fact that there is an imbalance between victim and aggressor, and also the use of aggressive behavior to humiliate or harm another person. There are different forms of cyberbullying behavior. Here, I'm just going to present you some examples, such as sending hurtful texts, images, and videos, spreading rumors about someone, targeting others through hurtful content and profiles, making threats, stalking others, and also suggesting and inciting suicides. Given the impact that cyberbullying has in mental health and well-being, but also in school adjustments and performance, there is an urgent need to prevent this phenomenon and also to use effective intervention strategies to deal with it. And so teachers can play a crucial role in the prevention and intervention in cyberbullying, thereby how they view cyberbullying, how they define it, the knowledge they have about strategies which can be used to solve a given situation, but also how they apply the knowledge they have in real situations can influence how they intervene with their students. However, what previous research has shown us is that teachers often report to have insufficient knowledge about cyberbullying, and also they indicate intervention strategies which are inconsistent. And if teachers do not feel confident to successfully intervene in a given situation involving their students, these may also interfere with their decision to help. Furthermore, what research has also shown us is that teachers frequently decide not to help their students when they are faced with a cyberbullying situation taking place in their schools. Furthermore, the seriousness which is attributed to a given behavior can also influence teachers' decision of intervening and helping. And so if a certain behavior is not considered to be serious, the probability of not intervening will certainly increase according with previous studies. So in accordance with the sociocognitive perspective of moral agency, individuals may act in ways opposing their personal moral standards, and these can contribute to accept or justify immoral or injurious behavior. And so in this sense, moral disengagement involves the selective detachment from moral self-sanctions, allowing individuals to remove their personal responsibility from immoral actions. And so this is particularly relevant because bystanders' passive behavior in cyberbullying situations was found to be related with the use of moral disengagement. So different moral disengagement mechanisms were associated positively with bystanders' behavior of ignoring a given situation or staying out of it. In the same line with the previous results, moral disengagement also seems to be related with teachers' passive behavior of not intervening or not helping their students when they know they are involved in a cyberbullying situation. However, little is known about teachers morally disengaging when they know about a cyberbullying situation and how this may relate with the knowledge they have about the phenomenon. Thereby, in the present study, we explored not only teachers' perceptions of cyberbullying, but also whether being aware of cyberbullying cases influences the development of moral disengagement mechanisms by teachers, also their perceived gravity of the situation and their perceived performance to solve a given situation. We also intended to understand whether teachers' acquired knowledge about the phenomenon determines how they perceive their performance, the gravity of the situation, and morally disengage from it. So also to understand the role of teachers' perceived knowledge about cyberbullying. Therefore, we conducted an X-Netted research, which involved 541 middle and high school teachers. We used the inventory of online security and cyberbullying, which is composed of both qualitative and quantitative items. And to analyze the data, we conducted a content analysis as for the qualitative data and performed structural equation modeling for the quantitative data. I also have to point out that all national and international ethical guidelines were followed to conduct this study. So now our research hypothesis. Hypothesis one, knowing a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior is positively associated with teachers' development of moral disengagement mechanisms. Hypothesis two, teachers' perceived knowledge about cyberbullying mediates the relation between knowing a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior and teachers' development of moral disengagement mechanisms, being this indirect effect negative. Hypothesis three, knowing a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior has an indirect effect in teachers' perceived performance to solve cyberbullying through their perceived knowledge of the phenomenon. And finally, hypothesis four, knowing a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior has an indirect effect in teachers' perceived gravity of cyberbullying through their perceived knowledge of the phenomenon. And so now I'm going to present you our conceptual model. Here you can see the different moral disengagement mechanisms which were accessed by our inventory, devaluing cyberbullying behavior, displacement of responsibility, justification of the intentions underlying cyberbullying behavior, and finally blaming the victim and devaluing the consequences. And so here we intended to understand if teachers knowing about a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior would be positively associated with their development of moral disengagement mechanisms. And so now our hypothesis two, the mediator effect of the perceived knowledge of cyberbullying in the former relationship. And finally, the indirect effect of the perceived knowledge of cyberbullying in the relation between knowing a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior and their perceived performance to solve cyberbullying, and also the same relation that considering the perceived gravity of cyberbullying. I will begin by presenting you the results from our qualitative data. So teachers were asked about their definitions of cyberbullying, so how they define cyberbullying. And so the results concerning teachers' perceptions revealed that the most prevalent defining feature of cyberbullying, which was reported by the teachers of our sample, was the use of electronic means, followed by the use of violent or aggressive behavior and the identification of the recipient of the action, which specifically refers to the fact that there is an individual to whom the behavior is directed to, in this case, the victim. Other defining features of cyberbullying were also mentioned by teachers, However, as you may observe, this was only by a smaller percentage of our samples, of our sample. When asked to define the cyberbullying, teachers also indicated different forms of cyberbullying behavior, which can be observed here. The most prevalent ones were insults, followed by harassment and threats. However, only a small percentage of teachers referred to cyberbullying behaviors, as you can see by the frequency percentages. Also, only 7% of the teachers referred the possible impact of cyberbullying when they were asked to define cyberbullying, and they indicated mainly suffering and negative effects on well-being. As for our quantitative results, our structural equation modeling analysis revealed that for our first hypothesis, teachers who knew a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior revealed a greater probability of developing moral disengagement mechanisms. Also, for our second hypothesis, when teachers revealed a greater perceived knowledge of cyberbullying, the former relationship was found to be weaker. As for our third hypothesis, an indirect effect of teachers' perceived knowledge of cyberbullying was found between teachers knowing a student who witnessed cyberbullying behavior and their perceived performance to solve cyberbullying. Finally, concerning our fourth hypothesis, we also found that teachers' perceived knowledge of cyberbullying explain the relation between knowing a student who witnessed cyberbullying and a greater perceived severity of the phenomenon. So here you can see that all the four hypotheses from these results about the quantitative data were confirmed. So now our conclusions. Although teachers were generally aware of about cyberbullying and as a problem which affects their students and were also able to generally define cyberbullying, we also observed that teachers disregarded important defining features of the phenomenon, such as the repetition of behavior and the occurrence between peers. Also, teachers only showed to have partial knowledge about the diverse forms of cyberbullying behavior, and also only a small part of the teachers referred to them. Moreover, and this is a particularly relevant result, teachers seemed less aware about the negative effects of cyberbullying on their students. Also, we found that teachers tend to morally disengage when they know about cyberbullying, about a student involved in a cyberbullying situation. However, when they perceive knowledge of cyberbullying, this seems to decrease their probability of morally disengaging. Moreover, the knowledge about cyberbullying can also increase teachers' perceived capability to solve cyberbullying and also to look at the phenomenon as a more serious problem. So just to conclude and refer to the implications of this study, we believe that our overall findings highlight the need of training actions for teachers in the field of cyberbullying and also about effective strategies to prevent and deal with it. These training actions could contribute to increase teachers' knowledge about the phenomenon, but also to decrease their chances of morally disengaging when they are faced with a cyberbullying event involving their students or taking place in their schools. Thus, this could contribute to a more effective intervention of teachers with their students when necessary. So now I leave you with the references for this study. And I also leave you with my contact information. You can contact me to ask about more details about this study or about the research that is taking place. Thank you very much for your time and for your attention.
Thank you all for coming. My name is Fia Francisco and I'm here to present part of my PhD investigation. My presentation is entitled, How Adolescents Report Empathy in Virtual Contexts and Moral Disengagement in Cyberbullying. As we all know, cyberbullying is a pervasive problem in our society, which is conceptualized as immoral behavior and unfortunately has been increasing. Despite the importance of its study, this is difficult since students tend to underrate their involvement in cyberbullying, which further demonstrates the importance of studying other related concepts such as empathy and moral disengagement. Empathy plays a crucial role in social interactions and human behavior. However, several factors may influence our willingness to behave empathically, such as prior similar experience or membership, where empathy is more experienced for in-group members, for example. Thus, widespread consensus that empathy is predetermined by circumstances. Moreover, several authors defend that empathy can be considered a trait, and in this sense, it is considered to be relatively stable over time. However, it can also be stimulated by serious games, for example. With respect to the relationship between empathy and cyberbullying, it is known that empathy is negatively related to cyberbullying perpetration, and considering the bystander's role, prosocial responses to cyberbullying are positively moderately correlated with empathy, and this increases as the severity of the incident also increases. Nonetheless, empathy alone does not seem to predict cyberbullying. Thus, other issues should be taken into account, such as the specifics of the online context in the assessment of empathy. Studies on empathy in virtual contexts are still scarce. But for example, some studies have found that virtual empathy was positively related with empathy in face-to-face interactions. However, virtual empathy was lower for both sexes. And with respect to cyberbullying, no difference between the different cyberbullying roles were found considering online empathy. So despite several instruments on empathy on online contexts have already been created, we chose to adapt the empathy quotient short form because the empathy quotient, the original, is the second most used instrument, and its short form has already been adapted to the Portuguese population. Considering other important constructs explaining cyberbullying, we have moral disengagement, which is related to the form by which people justify antisocial or immoral behavior. It refers to psychological mechanisms that people use to justify their conduct. In social cognitive theory of moral agency, there are four sites in the process of moral control at which moral self-censure can be selectively disengaged at different points in the self-regulatory process. And each one has mechanisms in order to accomplish the reduction of self-censure. These mechanisms allow moral self-sanctions to be selectively activated and disengaged from harmful behavior. As we can see, we have the behavior locus, agency locus, outcome locus, and recipient locus. And each one includes different moral disengagement mechanisms. Moral conduct is a product of selective activation of moral disengagement mechanisms. However, some features of information and communication technology may facilitate the use of certain moral disengagement mechanisms. For example, the lack of emotional cues may lead to dehumanization, and ambiguous communication may lead to blaming the victim. Thus, considering this, instruments on moral disengagement need to consider online features and cyberbullying situations. Several studies have already focused on online moral disengagement. For example, online and offline moral disengagement were correlated. However, they are distinct constructs. Moreover, online moral disengagement was higher for cyberbullies and cyber victims. As for moral disengagement, specifically in cyberbullying, several instruments have already been adapted. However, according to our view, we intended to assess the construct of moral disengagement as a process. Also, we'd like to capture adolescents' view regarding cyberbullying phenomenon. And finally, we wanted an instrument based on Bandura social cognitive theory, but that could also be complemented with new information about moral disengagement in cyberbullying situations. Therefore, a new instrument will be proposed. So the main objective of this study is to understand how adolescents experience empathy in online contexts and moral disengagement in cyberbullying situations. And to accomplish this goal, two instruments were adapted and developed. The empathy quotient in virtual contexts, which is adaptation of the AK short form in the Portuguese version, and the process moral disengagement in cyberbullying inventory, which is the new instrument we propose to assess moral disengagement in cyberbullying. In this presentation, only the bystander questionnaire will be validated. All necessary approvals were granted for this study, and three different samples were used. Regarding the adaptation of the EKDC, the 22 items from the EK short form, Portuguese version, were adapted to the online context. And then we proceeded to the facial validity with a 9th grade class. The second sample includes 34 ninth grade students who participated in-depth semi-structured interviews with cyberbullying scenarios, which were then content-analyzed with a mixed approach following social cognitive theory of moral agency. And finally, for the exploratory factor analysis of both instruments, 234 students participated. Regarding the empathy quotient in virtual contexts, from the exploratory factor analysis, we obtained two factors. The difficulties in empathizing refers to the difficulties students had in understanding why some things hurt other people online. For example, I find it hard to see why some things online bother people so much. The second factor, self-efficacy regarding empathy, is related to the perceived self-efficacy beliefs related to understanding how other people may feel, think, or behave online. For example, I find it easy to put myself in someone else's shoes online. Considering that the first factor included all items that were reverse worded, we attempted to test a unifactorial model to see if the model fit of this model was better than the bifactorial model with a separated method factor. However, the bifactorial model showed better fit. Moreover, the first factor has the same structure as the empathic difficulties from the key short form in the Portuguese version. We also conducted the graded response model and found three items with low discrimination. Therefore, those items were removed and the exploratory factor analysis was conducted again. This model showed good fit. However, the reliability of the first factor was just acceptable. As for the development of the process moral disengagement in cyberbullying inventory, it was divided in four phases. First, mixed content analysis. Next, generation of item pool, followed by expert evaluation, and finally, facial validity by students. This inventory has two distinct questionnaires, one for bystanders and one for aggressors. And each one includes 24 items for moral disengagement mechanisms, 3 items for the evaluation of behavioral intentions, and 9 items for attributions for the behavior, and an independent scale regarding non-intervention. For the content analysis, we considered the participants' point of view as bystanders. We propose a process model since we consider a timeline where an event, a need, or a characteristic motivated the aggressor's cyberbullying behavior. These are the antecedents. Then the cyberbullying behavior occurred, that is the behavior itself. And finally, this behavior generated consequences for both victims and bystanders, which are the consequences. This ABC categorization enabled us to understand the data from the participants' bystanders' perspective, how adolescents interpreted antecedents, described cyberbullying situations, and perceived cyberbullying consequences. Thus, through deductive reasoning, several moral disengagement mechanisms emerged, along with other attributions that emerged through inductive reasoning. Not all mechanisms emerged, and the most referred were blaming the victim, euphemistic labeling, and displacement of responsibility in their respective roles. Evaluation of behavioral intentions was a new mechanism that emerged, and it was included in the outcome levels. We conducted the exploratory factor analysis to all scales of the bystander questionnaire corresponding to the different levels, and all models presented good fit. After we conducted the greater response model, and all items had good discrimination, so no items were excluded from the questionnaire. Considering the empathy quotient in virtual contexts, it has a highly distinct structure from the original, which considered face-to-face interactions. Thus, instead of three original factors that were cognitive empathy, emotional reactivity, and social skills, EFA showed the bifactorial structure regarding the fact that difficulties in empathizing was all composed by reversal worded items and acceptable alpha, more investigation is needed. We found that the second factor is very interesting because it emphasizes the perceived capacity of students. And this is considered more important than the actual capacity, because these beliefs are the driving force to act in spite of the difficulties that may arise in the course of action. As for the process moral disengagement inventory, as the content analysis showed, not all mechanisms have the same impact in explaining cyberbullying. This is why the different locus should be considered separately. Moreover, moral disengagement should be considered as a process, since this view provides a better understanding of how cyberbullying starts and how adolescents perpetuate it, considering that some mechanisms tend to occur in specific times in the cyberbullying cycle. That is, some mechanisms are more evident in explaining aggressors' behavior, for example, blaming the victim, while others are more frequently used regarding bystanders' non-intervention, such as displacement of responsibility. So in the context of online empathy, it is of major importance that the adolescents feel that they are capable of dealing with cyberbullying situations, specifically considering that online teachers tend to difficult feeling empathy. This emphasizes the importance of empathy in those contexts. Also, self-efficacy regarding empathy should be a key factor in cyberbullying prevention and intervention programs, since it is the driving force to act even though obstacles are present. Also, it is important to continue investigating both empathy and moral disengagement in this context. For example, confirmatory factor analysis was already conducted and it showed good results, especially with respect to process moral disengagement in cyberbullying inventory. As for the empathy quotient in virtual context, results are satisfactory. However, we consider more research is needed, especially considering the difficulties in empathizing. However, other analysis should be conducted, such as convergent and divergent validity and model invariance, for example. With respect to moral disengagement in cyberbullying, we consider that the distinctive feature of the new venture regarding aggressors and bystanders' perspectives allows us to understand the role of moral disengagement with respect to the different roles in the cyberbullying cycle. Moreover, some scales of the inventory may prove to be more useful than others, considering the specificities and needs of each population, as well as the investigation objectives. Also, more investigation is needed on how those constructs are related and how they are related to cyberbullying perpetration and pro-social bystander behavior. And finally, we believe that these variables are important to include in cyberbullying prevention and intervention programs. So I think we can conclude that understanding empathy in virtual contexts and moral disengagement in cyberbullying is one of the main challenges in tackling cyberbullying, considering their major importance in the adolescent's behavior and in their willingness to intervene. So thank you very much for your attention and goodbye.
Hello to everyone. My name is Christian Berger, and I will be presenting our work about extracurricular activities and its association with peer victimization in the role of gender and school norms. First, I want to acknowledge our funding projects, PROSA, COES, and Dr. Dorothy Espelas, who has been collaborating with us in this study. First, we all know that extracurricular activities are kind of a different scenario. Usually research on child and adolescent development is focused on classroom settings and formal settings, although there's a large proportion of adolescents participating in extracurricular activities, 44% in the US, and in the case of Chile, where our studies is being developed, 34%. We also know that there's a lot of evidence showing the association between participating in these activities and several indicators of well-being and positive development, such as social competence, prosociality, active citizenship, several mental health indicators, and opportunities for developing nurturing and intimate relationships. However, there is also some evidence associating extracurricular activities and victimization. By one hand, participating in these activities has been proposed as a protective factor against bullying and other forms of aggression. But also, involvement in these activities could expose adolescents to kind of problems, alcohol use, and pre-victimization. And some examples of this, about these inconclusive findings, is, for instance, the higher rates of victimization have been shown where involvement is specifically in academic-oriented extracurricular activities, also when this involvement is in non-sport extracurricular activities, or even when involvement or participation is in three or more classroom-related extracurricular activities or intramural sports. So how can we understand this, by one hand, the positive effect of participating in these activities on well-being, but at the same time, the possibility of being victimized? And we are building on the social fit hypothesis, in which we believe that the fit between individuals' interests and behaviors and social norms is associated with social adjustment and therefore less victimization. And we are working with two different norms here or reference. One is gender stereotypes, and we are starting from the idea that sports activities are usually defined as male, and academic and all our activities are usually associated with females, right? So the gender stereotype will sanction those kids, boys or girls, who don't match these norms. And then we have the school norms, the descriptive norms about participating in extracurricular activities, which basically means the proportion of students participating in these activities within each school. So our study hypothesis, first, we believe that participating in sport extracurricular activities will be associated with lower victimization for boys, but higher for girls, following gender stereotypes. The opposite will happen for academic and art activities, where participation will be associated with lower victimization for girls, but higher for boys. And these effects will be moderated by the school social norms, that is the overall participation in these activities within school. Moving to the method, we are using a very large sample, which is representative from Chile, from the whole country. This is the National Survey of Violence in School Context. It features more or less 38,000 7 to 12 students, aged 12 to 18. It is representative for all regions and all types of schools in the whole country. We, for this analysis, we are only using the items for relational victimization, which are three: ignoring, excluding, and making fun of. It's self-reported. And two items for participating in sports: one, in academic or art activities. Sports are competitive team sports, and academic arts refer to debate club, music, bands, or those kind of activities. And we use hierarchical logistic modeling for our analysis. Sorry. So let's move to the results. First, this is just to check this gender nature of extracurricular activities. As you can see on the left panel, this is participation in cultural art activities. As you can see, females are more likely to participate in these activities than boys. And there's a decrease over the years in participation. And on the right side, you can see that boys are much more likely to participate in extracurricular activities when there are sports activities as compared to girls. And again, there's this decline over time. Overall, you see the participation starts in around 40%, 38-40% in seventh grade, and decrease until 30% in 12th grade. And again, this shows the gender nature of this activity. So both activities are offered equally for boys and girls in schools. There's no selection process, but still you can see the participation is different for boys and girls in these activities. Just the overall table of effects, and we are here calculating the odds ratio for participating, for victimizations, excuse me. And what are the predictors for victimization within this context? As you can see, girls are less likely to be victimized than boys. Participating in sports activities is associated with increases in victimization. There's a decrease in victimization over the years. At the school level, we found that the voucher school, which is private but with subsidized of the government, in those schools there's more victimization as compared to public schools. And only girls' schools, there's less victimization as compared to mixed schools. And we also found an interaction effect between gender and participating in sports extracurricular activities, right? So now we're going to try to get in deep with this analysis and the specific effects on victimization, comparing, as I said, tell you before, gender and the norms regarding gender and the school norm in participation. This is our first analysis, is the interaction between gender and participating in sports extracurricular activities, focus on sports. The left panel, the left graph, is showing the association between participating in sport and the degree to which people participate, from non-participation or activities that are not implemented to always participating, and the probability of being victimized. And on the right side, you see the proportion of sport participation in the school, which goes from 0 to 1, or everyone's participating, and again, the probability of victimization. The blue line are females and the red line are males. So first we confirm our first hypothesis. For boys, the more they participate in sport and extracurricular activities, their likability of being relationally victimized decreases. By contrast, for girls, girls who increase their probability of being victimized as they increase their participation in sport extracurricular activities. So again, there's this gender pattern in which if you fit the norm of boys doing sports, you are less likely to be victimized, whereas for girls, if you break the norm, you're more likely to be victimized over time. We also see the association between the proportion of participation in the whole school and the probability of being victimized. And as you can see, overall school participation in sport activities is associated with higher victimization, and the correlation at the school level, it's 0.21. So the normative it is to participate in sport activities, there's more victimization overall in the school. This is a note in the method. The sample includes over 700 schools, so it's quite a big sample. So the analysis is quite stable across school types and regions. Our same analysis, the association or interaction between gender and participating in academic art activities, but for again for academic art activities specifically, in here we see a different pattern. Remember the gender assumption that boys are more likely to be involved in sports and girls in academic and not participation. We first see that we reject our second hypothesis. There's no significant difference between boys and girls participation in academic and art activities on relation victimization. As you see the patterns, even though we can see a small difference, they are not significant. And overall school participation in academic art activities is associated in this case with lower victimization. So the more prevalent it is to participate in this in a school, the less likely it is to be victimized at the school. So and this might have to do with the type of activities and what is implied in academic and art activities as a matter of how relations are built. Let me go to our final analysis, which is talking on hypothesis 3. This is the moderating effect of the school norm on this association. And as you can see here, we're focusing only in sport activities. As you see the left panel, it's addressing males. The right panel is addressing females. We are comparing three groups here, those who never participate or who report that there are no such activities in their schools, those who rarely participate, and those who always participate, the red, green, and blue lines. And on the x-axis, you see the proportion of sport participation ranging from 0 to 1, so no one or everyone is participating in your school, and the probability of being victimized, comparing the slides. As you can see, for boys, those who always participate in sport extracurricular activities decrease the probability of victimization when the school social norm increases. This is the blue line. So the more you participate and the more prevalent it is to participate in your school, the less likely you are to be victimized. So this group, we could think of them as fitting both the gender and the school social norm. So they are boys participating in sports, which is by one hand, gender norm, but then they are participating in sports in a school where participating is normative. So they are really not sanctioned by the group. As compared, for instance, to the red group, which are boys who to report not having those activities or not participating in these activities, which is against the social norm, school social norms. For girls, when school participation in sports is increases, the association between the participation and victimization, although still positive, decreases. This is the blue line. So as you can see, females are crossing the gender norm when participating in sports. So they are increasing the likability of being victimized. But at the same time, this effect, it's moderated when it is normative in their school to participate in sport activities. So these two norms kind of enter in a conflict in their effects. So just to sum up, we can conclude from our study that participating in extracurricular activities has not a straightforward effect on social adjustment and consequently on victimization. It might depend on the type of activity. And one of the limitations of the studies is the items for assessing participation, they are really wide, and we cannot focus on specific type of sports or academic art activities. They are just an overall item. The sex of the participants, very important. Normative school context, which we use as a proxy, the percentage of participation, right, the norm, and the interaction between these factors, gender, the gender stereotype, and the school norm. We also see that relational victimization seems to sanction the deviance from the expected norm, either the gender norm, that is boys in sports, girls in academic arts, or the descriptive social norm, normativity of participation in schools. And as informing interventions and what we could do with this data, so intervention should offer a wide variety of extracurricular activities, promoting inclusive activities that are not exclusive or targeted to boys and girls, or at least being really explicit in saying that these are for both, and addressing gender stereotypes across all levels of the school ecology. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm available for any contact about this data.